Right then, so this weekend, I'm fitting Airtec Stage 3 intercooler, ProAlloy rad, an Airtec oil cooler, aircon delete, new oil and filter, new coolant reservoir, hard pipes, silicone water pipes, and I think that's it. To the Astra VXR. First up, the front wheels are coming off for better access to the bumper screws and for the oil and filter change that we'll be doing later. There's a couple of torque screws in each wheel arch. Not sure why I undid these by hand, but I do recommend getting a drill on them to save yourself a few minutes. I also had to remove my towing eye, which I'd left in since the last track day I did, just to avoid breaking or losing the cover, taking it off and putting it back on again for each one in the future. Here I'm undoing the three torque screws that hold the upper grille on, and then the three push pins that attach the under tray to the front subframe. These are really stiff, and pulling on them actually just bends the heads, so they're a bit of a pain to get out. Next, I've unplugged the fog lights, and it's a good idea to do the air temperature sensor in the lower grille at the same time, which I forgot to do until the end. Then both ends of the bumper can be unclipped. And the upper grille just lifts off, revealing two more plastic push pin things, which have to be removed before you can take off the bumper.
The AC rad's looking a bit worse than for wear. And of course, as they all do, the bottom rows come off it, which is where all the gas went. So it's safe to remove this without degassing the aircon, because there's nothing in it. Which is why my aircon stopped working a few weeks after getting the car.
Now the headlights have to come off, which is just three screws and a plug on each. And this is so we can get to the bolts on the end of the crash bar at the front, which, if they've never been off before, will be in with the head facing up and the nut facing down, so you can't actually pull the bolt out because the headlights are in the way. When putting the crash bar back on, it's a good idea to push the bolts through from the bottom and put the nuts on top. That way the headlights don't have to come off when removing the crash bar in the future. There's also this wiring loom attached to the crash bar, and the best way of getting those clips out I found was levering them off with the back of a hammer. Pulling them with pliers, there just wasn't enough to grab onto. Now it's time to start working on removing the rad pack, starting with draining the radiator so the coolant has a lot of time to drip out before we actually remove the rad. I attached a length of hose, which is actually, I think, a drain tube off a Vectra airbox, and this just keeps the coolant from going all over the subframe. Then it's as simple as opening the valve and removing the cap off the coolant reservoir, and the coolant should all start to drop out. The AC rad has to be removed for both the AC delete and to replace the radiator and intercooler. So first, both lines are disconnected. Then the AC wiring loom is unplugged from the sensors, the compressor, and the AC fan. Then there's just four screws holding on the AC rad. And with the aircon rad out of the way, it's time to take off the intercooler, starting with the boost hoses at the top. And then there's this little screw under the slam panel that holds this top boost pipe onto the radiator.
How can I get to that? This won't fit.
Which, if I'd removed the slam panel earlier in the job, would have been easy to get out of the way. But instead, I disconnected the rubber pipe from the metal boost pipe, allowing me to lift the intercooler out, leaving the metal boost pipe in place. Finally, the three coolant hoses on the radiator can be removed, and with the top radiator mounts unbolted, the radiator should just lift out of the radiator bushings at the bottom. With the full rad pack out of the way, we get this pretty sick view of the downpipe, which is turned blue with a bunch of heat cycles while on track and just blasting about. The top rubber mounts can be removed off the old radiator and pushed onto the new one, and the bottom ones I'm taking off the subframe of the car and replacing with PowerFlex ones. However, the PowerFlex Black Series radiator bushings are pretty hard to install. I ended up stacking the two radiator mounts on top of each other to create an air gap behind the bushing that I'm pushing in, and then squeezing them in with a vise, because no amount of vise grips while they were still on the car would actually push the bushings through. And you can see even with the vise, that's trying to pop back out.
I think that's finally in. I have to manage the same on the other side. Yeah. So a bench vise is the way to go, not vise grips on the car. Take it off and squish it.
And with that done, the newly upgraded mounts can be reattached to the car, although I would recommend leaving these loose so that when you fit the new radiator, you can adjust the angle so it slides in easier. Before the new rad goes on though, while we've got such good access, it's a good idea to get on with the AC delete by removing the lines going to the compressor and eventually the compressor itself, and also to replace this coolant hose with the silicone one that I bought, while the access to the clamp is so good. For the coolant hose on the other side that goes to the rad, the battery and battery tray have to be removed, once again for better access to the clamps, and then the new hose goes on just as the old one came off, but with some nice new Jubilee clips. Also, the threads on my coolant reservoir are toast and the cat's been coming undone, so I'm replacing that while I'm at it.
Reckless you, my God.
Here we go.
Fucking reckless you. Jesus Christ.
It's old one.
Fucking hell, James.
What?
I thought I was bad. He said, it's screwed, have I?
Got it off, didn't it?
Hey?
Got it off, didn't it?
In one piece or not.
It looks so much nicer, doesn't it, when you've got a fresh one?
I'm not cleaner. It is when you peel the fucking sticker off, it stays on bottom.
Yeah. I might just leave it on, you know. Right. Update on where we are, because it looks like an absolute war zone. I need to tidy up. So I forgot to film a bit. Because Asan come round, Ultimate Garage YouTube, if you want to check him out. So, we've ragged all this aircon line out. Which obviously won't be needed anymore. No intention of ever putting aircon back in car. Eventually it'll be too far gone for anyone to consider it anyway. So, that were a pain in the ass. This engine mount had to come up. And it then didn't line back up to put it back on. But these coolant hoses are fitted. New coolant res. Obviously, all rad packs out of the way. And yeah, there's no AC lines left in car. So I'm going to tidy up and call it a day so I don't get sick of it. And tomorrow I'll be taking this wheel arch off, draining oil, oil filter change, taking the aux belt off. While the rad's off, that's why I'm sort of doing multiple jobs at once. While the rad's off, it's really easy to unbolt the AC compressor and drop that out. Otherwise, I don't think it'll come out. There's definitely no room to drop it through the bottom. And you'd struggle to get it out of the top, but... And maybe you wouldn't, to be fair. But yeah, I'm going to take that off. It doesn't matter that I've got loads of stuff unplugged. I'm going to just code out the AC, and the car should be fine with it. I can do that with Opcom. So yeah, we're getting there. There's like a lot to do, but also... solid plan for order to do it all in.
The next day, Courtney wanted to find out if she could do the sump plug without getting covered in oil, and failed spectacularly.
Glad I'm not doing it.
While the oil drains, the arch liner that covers the oil filter and the aux belt can be removed, which is one Torx screw and two trim clips on the side, and then two Torx screws underneath. With a 15mm spanner on the bolt through the aux tensioner, the tension is removed and the aux belt lifts off. Going the other way with the spanner, the aux tensioner pulley can be removed completely, so we can replace it with the ribbed one that comes with the RnD AC Delete kit, which makes it harder or impossible for the belt to pop off like it does when using a smooth pulley like some of the cheaper AC deletes. The next step is a bit fiddly, and that's passing the blanking plate through to the firewall and bolting it on where the AC lines used to go into the firewall. By sticking the bolt to the blanking plate with a bit of glue, I made it easier to get it over there without dropping the bolt though. And now it's finally time to remove that aircon compressor, which easily shaves 10 kilograms off the weight of the car, and then I'm going to fit the new aux belt. It's worth checking with any AC delete that the aux belt isn't now about to touch the banjo bolts on the oil filter housing. In this case, I got lucky and there's no rubbing, but it completely depends on what angle the factory set the oil filter housing at, so it's worth checking. I took the old oil filter off with a pair of oil filter pliers, and before fitting the new oil filter, the sandwich plate for the oil cooler has to go on first. Just like fitting a new oil filter, the rubber seal is first lubricated with fresh oil, and then the sandwich plate is offered up, and a brass fitting goes through the middle of it to hold it on, and this is unfortunately super hard to get a wrench around, as you can see here, to get it completely tight, but I got there in the end. Next up, the barbs for the oil lines for the oil cooler, and once again, there's huge access issues actually getting a wrench on them, and you have to make sure the angle's right so that they're not too close to the crank pulley for the aux belt, otherwise it can rub or knock on the crank pulley, which might cause some damage. I had to run to Halfords and pick up some Jubilee clips because although the Airtec fitting instructions said the kit should have come with some Jubilee clips, there were definitely none in the box. With the oil lines pushed onto the barbs and clamped on though, it's time for the new filter finally, which is pre-filled and the seal is lubed as before. Then I cleaned the area with Auto Glim engine and machine cleaner because oil always gets all over the front wishbone. Finally, before oil can go back in it, a new sump plug has to be fitted, and I really broke open the piggy bank for one of these magnetic sump plugs, just for the peace of mind. I'll put oil and coolant in the car at the same time later on, when it's finally ready to start up again, but before that, I'm going to remove the fan off the factory radiator, as I'm going to be reusing it on the ProAlloy rad, simply because I don't need the extra cooling of expensive spal fans. After drilling out a bolt holding on the fan shroud that had rounded off, the fan shroud has to be trimmed flat using a grinding disc on the Dremel so that it fits relatively flush against the ProAlloy rad. And basically what you want to do is measure, I think, 12mm from the taller side of the fan shroud and just cut along horizontal, tapering off to the other side. This was a bit more painful than expected because the non-reinforced Dremel cutting discs are absolutely useless, and I ended up using a hacksaw for part of it. After sanding down any rough edges, the fan shroud can be bolted to the radiator. Just using the existing holes and the shiny new bolts that come with the radiator, there's a tab on the bottom of the radiator that the fan shroud slots into, and the bottom left screw hole was previously used to secure the wiring harness, so the plastic clip that was there is removed and replaced with a new bolt. Now it's time to really start putting the car back together, starting with fitting the new radiator. It's a bit of a squeeze, and in the end, I found the only way to really get it in, especially with the PowerFlex radiator bushers, is to get the radiator into the top mounts and the bottom right mount, then loosen off the bottom left mount, attach it to the radiator, then slide it above the subframe and bolt it back to the car. I pulled off this boost hose to get better access to the coolant hoses below, and by pulled off, I mean I had to cut it off because it was on so tight. Then I could fit the new silicone coolant hose to the rad. And here I'm just reusing the factory coolant returns and those awful radiator hose clamps that come with them. And this really shows off the quality of the ProAlloy cooler, because I've heard complaints that the cheaper gravity performance coolers don't have long enough metal pipes for the silicone hoses to actually clamp onto properly, whereas on the ProAlloy there's actually loads of room. The rad fan is plugged back in, and that's it, the radiator is fully fitted.
Off camera, I've refitted the intake, the crash bar, and I've attached one of the oil cooler lines. So what I'm going to do now is find a clean funnel and pre-fill the oil cooler with this fresh Valvoline Synpower. That way, when the thermostat opens, the oil level won't drop too much the first time around before it gets topped up, because these lines will have nothing in them, but at least the cooler will be full. And then I'm going to screw this line on, and then that should be a sealed system. I can flip it around and mount it just above here.
The Airtec front mount oil cooler kit comes with self tappers to hold the oil cooler bracket onto the front crash bar. So I drilled 4 or 4.5mm pilot holes in the bottom of the crash bar and screwed the oil cooler on. However, it turns out that this was a bit of a mistake and I just didn't read the instructions properly, and the bracket actually goes on top of the crash bar so the cooler fits a few inches higher. Because when it came time to offer up the intercooler, the oil cooler lines were completely in the way. So, as quick as it went on, the oil cooler had to be removed and refitted on top.
So, quick update, what you've probably just seen is by hanging this under the crash bar, over the crash bar, like I saw in the instructions, and completely didn't realise I'd done wrong. The oil lines were kind of in the way of stage 3 intercooler fitting. So, I've unscrewed those. Now there's two holes in the bottom of the crash bar for no reason. Plan is to drill some more holes. I'll probably put riv nuts in rather than self-tappers, because self-tappers are supplied. Do that when you try to self-tap them into aluminium. They just round off. Yeah, they're just not up to the job. So riv nuts it is. Probably do the same for the intercooler, which means I've got like six holes to drill or something. But everything fits now. Oil pipes go down there. There's going to be an intercooler pipe go down that way. We've got to make sure these aren't rubbing on anything. They look mostly fine, just below that corner. Yeah, they sort of touch there, but we'll see what we can do about that. If anything, horn has to be relocated over there underneath this one to make space for the boost pipe. But yeah, I'm going to get drilling and hopefully we can call the day soon.
So as past me explained, I'm now drilling some holes for riv nuts to better secure the oil cooler. I will note that the only riv nuts I have are galvanized steel, which is more electronegative than the aluminium crash bar, so it could cause some corrosion, but I'll keep an eye on it. I'm sure you can get aluminium riv nuts, which I could replace these with in the future, but I don't think it's going to be a huge issue. We'll see how it goes anyway. But with the cooler attached by M6 bolts and riv nuts, it's so much cleaner, and the bolts won't have to be replaced every single time the cooler comes off in the future, which they probably would have with those self-tappers made of cheese. And here I'm just doing the exact same for the intercooler brackets. Having already marked the locations, the holes should be drilled with a center punch before moving the intercooler out of the way so I can get a drill in. And this was the exact same as the oil cooler. Airtec expect you to mount it with self-tapping screws, which just doesn't fill me with confidence.
There we have it. Front mount intercooler, purely front mounted. It's a bit off to the left, but I did test fit lower bumper and seems to still fit fine. This overhangs a bit, but there's nothing sort of in the way. The reason it's to the left is because the washer bottle just barely clears here. See a lot of that light through it. Left literally half a mil between those. Pretty solid even with just the two bolts resting up against the rad. Probably flip the rad bushings round, have the rad tilt back a bit to get yourself a bit more room. I wish I'd done that at the time, but because they're the PowerFlex ones, I really don't fancy redoing them. So, I need to... There's a lower brace for this. I need to fit. There's somewhere back here, I think. Hold. Yeah, you can see the tab on the back of the intercooler. To hold the intercooler steady so it doesn't rock backwards and forwards. So that needs fitting. And then the bumper can go back on. Well, I'm going to run it for 20 minutes to temperature with boiling coolant in it before fitting the bumper, just so I've got easy access to everything in case there's any leaks. But we're getting there. This is pretty promising.
So now the horn can be relocated so that we can throw some boost pipes on. The best way of doing this is to remove the arm that holds the right horn and just bolt the right horn on top of the left one, using the same bolt to attach both brackets to the car. Now this 90 degree boost elbow can be attached, remembering to loosen the clamp enough so it fits over the bead, which I didn't do at first. Then the factory boost pipe can be removed from the turbo outlet. And it's replaced with this 90 degree hard pipe and a silicone coupler. For the boost pipe on the other side, the slam panel is going to have to come unbolted, then it simply lifts up and the boost pipe can be slotted underneath. However, these 2.5-inch boost pipes are never going to fit with the massive radiator in the way. They might if you're running a stock rad, but definitely not with the Pro Alloy. So unfortunately, the slam panel is going to have to get chopped, but thankfully it'll be covered up by the front grille when that's back in place. The way I've seen other people doing this, such as 4-cylinder performance on YouTube, is just lop off that third bolt hole from the car and secure the slam panel with the other two instead. And then the rear of the slam panel also needs some gentle clearance in, shall we call it, to make the pipe fit through. Unfortunately, just from the test fitting, the pipe got absolutely covered in scratches, so I may have to take it off in the future and get it re-powder coated or dust it with some satin black spray paint or something.
So the only bit still touching now is this, but there's this captive nut screw thing for holding on the bonnet release cable, which you don't want dangling about. So I'll move this up here, not have screw thing, move it to this side maybe, or alternatively just cut this bit off. I'm thinking of cutting the whole lot and moving this to the other side if I can. Another update, I've not been filming stuff because I don't want this video to drag on forever, but intercooler bracket on the bottom is now fitted. Put that plastic thing back onto crash bar. Still need to zip tie this up out of the way. Attach these pipes. Up the hose clamps on these ones because I didn't show that on camera. Yeah, ones to the turbo and this. So, intercooler, oil cooler, and rad all plumbed in and fitted.
Pretty cool, I would say.
Oil, coolant, and I'll start it up and check it for leaks basically. Hopefully, there aren't any. And the oil cooler will only find out really once it's up to temp. But these aluminium fittings seem promising, so hopefully, they don't leak. One concern, to be fair, is these barbs where they screw into the actual thing. This one, this bottom one, I'm not sure I did tight enough, honestly. But we'll see. We'll see how it goes. So yeah, got to be putting fluids in it.
And with the fluids in, it's finally time for a test startup and a little rev to check for leaks and to bleed the cooling system. I'd like to be my own worst enemy. There's no risk if you don't try it anything. So I'ma just get by in everything. See you in the next life to be a better me. I don't think that my head's on straight. Gotta flip it and grip it and go and get an x-ray. What's wrong with me? I just feel weight pushing on my chest and it squeezes till I suffocate. Better change my mindset, meditate. It's pretty cool that I'm alive and have better days. I could walk, see here. Right, it seems to be working, which is a good start. There's no huge amount of oil dripping yet. The thermostat and sandwich plate thing may have a little bit weeping out of it, so I may have to give that a crank down. We'll see. Might be just fine yet. Yeah, I'm gonna leave it running with the blowers on, try and get the coolant system bled, because there's only like 5 litres in there. I'm sure they're meant to take 6 or 7, especially with the bigger rad. So yeah, I don't know if there'll be any more on this video. We'll see when I get the bumper on and all of that. Might be another day. Might be another video. Yeah, thanks for watching. So yeah, that's it for this video. Thanks for watching. Do a subscribe if you want to see some more content in the future on the VXR. And check out the 20 previous videos in this series if you haven't already seen them. Not okay, all I want, and I pray, all I need are some better days.